Y'all ready there? Would you say amen?
Amen.
Verse number 6 is where I like to start reading. Now, the Bible says, he spake also this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard. He came and sought the fruit thereon and found none. Then said he unto the dresser of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I have come seeking fruit on this tree and find none. Cut it down, why cumbereth it the ground? And he answered and said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, till I shall dig about it and dug it. And if it bear fruit, well. And if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. Let us have prayer. Father, we want to thank you, Lord, for this portion of your word of God tonight. Lord, Father, the good spirit that I feel here already. I know folks has been in a hurry to get here and to get settled in. And Father, well, I don't want them to come all this way in vain. Lord, I want to speak words that are weighty. Lord, I'm not coming here to blow my own horn, but Father, to magnify and exalt you and your word. I agree with the Apostle Paul when he said that I must decrease, but you must increase. Father, give Brother Harrison, both of them, Lord, traveling grace on their travels, Lord, Father, wherever they may be. Bless this church mightily, Father, as you already have, and continue to do so, if you would please. And our church, Father, as we represent it here tonight also, we'll thank you, Father, for all that you do for us now. In Jesus' name we pray. God's children said,
Amen.
For 3 years, the Bible declares right here that this man has given watch over a certain tree. The Bible says it is a fig tree. If you'll notice down in verse number 7, the Bible says, he said unto the dresser of the vineyard, behold, these 3 years this Lord has come by and he has actually sought for fruit on the vine from this tree. Well, that's mighty interesting because he tells us, he says, now this year, if it's not productive, then what we're going to do is we're going to actually cut this tree down. So by them cutting this tree down, we must understand something. In order for a fig tree to bear fruit, it takes actually 3 years to actually bear fruit. And is that better? Amen. Is that better? I forgot to cut myself on. Amen. As long as you don't turn me off, how about that? For 3 years, it takes 3 years for a fig tree to bear fruit. And if it did bear fruit on the fourth year, that was known as the first fruit. So the first fruit was actually dedicated to the Lord. So there we have 4 years already. 3 years to bear fruit. The first year that it may or may not bear fruit was dedicated to the Lord. And according to the story that Jesus tells us, or this parable, the Bible says here that he's waited 3 years for it to bear fruit again. So in all in total, the dresser of this vineyard and the Lord came seeking fruit from this fig tree. It has been sitting there a total of 7 years and it has not bore no fruit, no fruit to bear any. We're just into this year right now, just a quarter of a year has done past us. And many of you probably made earlier this year when it come time for maybe a watch night service, or maybe it was a dedication service, maybe one of those good moves of God that come in here in this building and the altar fills up and dedications and vows was made around this altar here. Maybe beginning on the first of the year, many of you like the most crowd do. They want to try to start this year out right. Amen.
Yeah.
Can I get away this right there? Maybe you want to start this year out right. And maybe physically you decided that you was probably going to maybe drop some pounds. Maybe try to exercise a little bit and get back in shape, you know, instead of the round shape. You want to get in the real shape, you know, much like me tonight. Amen. And my wife told me, she says, honey, she says, you're a little bit heavy. You need to get in shape. And I says, I am in shape. Though shape is round. Amen. And she didn't like that too much. And anyway, I went to the doctor the other day, and they told me, she said, well, preacher says you're healthy as a horse. I said, really? I said, yes. Yeah. If you're big as one, too, you need to lose some weight. Amen. Amen. I just wonder if I had to pay for that insult. Amen. But many of us make vows and stuff, and we make those vows, or we make dedications and stuff at the beginning of some season or some revival meeting, maybe whatever it is. And then as the year progresses, as it gets along, sometimes those boughs seem to wane off. Sometimes they just don't hold the water or the elasticity that it did in the beginning of it. It don't seem just as surreal or real to us anymore as the vows or the dedication that we had done early on. Maybe at the beginning of this year, maybe some of us decided we was going to read our Bibles through. Amen. That's a good thing to do. Wouldn't you say that? I ate four of you do anyway. I said, wouldn't it be good if we all decided we just want to read our Bibles through? I set aside about 10, 15 minutes a day and lay the remote control down and turn the radio off and unto God, cut the cell phones off and stop the text messaging and the social networking stuff and start to really dip into the Word of God. Wouldn't that be nice, amen? If we would religiously educate ourselves to take God's Word to really soak it in, you know, wouldn't that be nice tonight if that would happen, something like that? Hey, but oftentimes as our time progresses, it seems like our vows or our ambitions are just kind of waning off just a little bit. You know something, ladies and gentlemen, I think on a scale of 1 to 10, where do you and I stand tonight when it comes to this thing, not only not physically, but spiritually when it comes to the things of God? I mean, honestly, tonight. I mean, I don't think I'm just preaching to the choir tonight. I think we all can use some vast improvement in our spirituality and our walk with the Lord. Would you agree with that tonight?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Or on me, yeah. One of the two. I think we can all use that improvement with our walk with the Lord.
Right.
I think we can all use that improvement with our walk with the Lord. I said, I think we can all use that improvement with our walk with the Lord. Amen. Hey, I know it's Wednesday night, okay? Amen. You can say amen on Wednesday just because you can't Sunday. Amen. That's right. Ladies and gentlemen, I realize tonight that this keeper of the vineyard, this Lord, comes seeking for that fruit. And he says, look here, I've waited 7 years. But notice what he says down in verse number 8. He answered and said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year. He says, and he says, I shall dig about it. And he dug it. He says, what I want you to do. He says, Lord, I just want you to know, just give this tree, look here. He said, just give this tree one more year to produce some fruit. Just one more year. He says, I'm going to dig about it. I'm going to dress it. He says, I'm going to till the ground. I'm going to be sure this well kept, and we're going to give this tree one more year. And then after the year, if it don't produce fruit, if you look down at verse number 9, what happens to the tree? The Bible says that the dresser of the vineyard says that if it don't bear no fruit, then we're going to end up going to cut it down. Amen? Well, that's a sad report, don't it, huh?
Yeah.
I wonder if this year, we're into this January, February, March, and we're at the end of March right now, fixed we're 3 months into this year right now. Now I wonder tonight, besides coming this 365 days that are coming to this year, I wonder tonight how many of us have actually made dedications or actually tried to improve our spiritual walk with the Lord. I wonder if God gives us actually another year to live. Because honestly, let's just say, and we all know this to be true, we have not the promise of tomorrow.
That's right.
We don't know. Amen. We don't know. Amen. We can just leave the church building tonight and get snuffed out of the air. I mean, everybody in this building knows how dangerous Highway 64 is. Amen. Amen. And by the way, that yellow line don't protect you from that 2-ton or 3-ton or 8-ton bullet coming right at you from the other side. Amen. Hey, ladies, we don't have that guarantee. But ladies and gentlemen, what we could do, what we ought to do, hey, is actually trying to be producing fruit. Jesus says here, he says, this tree, if it don't produce fruit, then it needs to be cut down. Ain't that some sad report? I mean, honestly, besides an anniversary this year, besides a birthday this year, besides the 365 days that are in this year, if God gives you 365 more days, what's going to improve in your spiritual life for the Lord? Look here, there are verses right here. Look down here in this verse in verse number seven. He said unto the dresser of the vineyard, behold, these 3 years I have come seeking fruit on this tree, and I find none. Cut it down. Why cumbereth it the ground? Cumbereth it. He was actually taking some extra time with this tree right here, pruning it and dressing it, making sure it got the right fertility, the fertilizer, the oil, the water, made sure that the soil was susceptible to water drainage.
And he done everything, cut all the trees around it, around away from it, that it got the proper sunlight. He done everything there could to be sure to ensue this tree God was producing fruit at 7 years old. Amen. Mm. Now I want to ask you a question tonight. If God gives you one more year, what's going to be changed about your life? There might be somebody sitting here in this building tonight, even on Sunday morning. Even in our families, as God gives us one more year, we may not even be here. Yeah. Amen?
Right.
If God gives us one more year, I've got three questions I'm going to give to you. We're going to go to house here in just a few minutes. If God gives us 365 more days, will your life be pleasing to the Lord? Will your life be pleasing to you? You see, this farmer here has invested a lot of time in this thing. And no doubt, ladies and gentlemen, by the way, God has invested a lot of time in us too. I mean, how many of us in here can say tonight that God has not shined a little sunshine on our day? Has not God rained? Has not God watered us, spiritually speaking? Has God not clothed us as he does the lily of the valley? Has God not took care of us and answered prayer? Has God not fed us? Amen. Has God not saved some? Amen. God has done all that for us. And I want to ask you, if God gives us another year, what are you going to do for him? Is your life actually going to be pleasing unto him? You see, a lot of people have this idea of getting out of what God can give to us. That's not the problem. Ladies and gentlemen, it's up to us to give to God what we can give him. Amen. Some people have this role reversal, and it's totally wrong. Hey, they're in it for what they can get out of it. Hey, I didn't come, my friend, tonight to get in it what I can get out of it. I come to put in it what I can to give God the glory. Amen. Amen. Not a glory seeker. Those people, my friend, that stroke their own egos. If God gives you, ladies and gentlemen, if God gives Bethel 365 more days, are you going to be more pleasing to the Lord? Here tonight, ladies and gentlemen, Revelation chapter number 4, verse number 11 tells us that we're not made just for ourselves. We're made by the craftsmanship and the workmanship of God, and we're sent for his glory and his honor, not ourselves. Amen. God gives us one more year. Amen. Honestly, ladies and gentlemen, God gives us one more year. Oh, we're going to be more pleased with the Lord. You know what's so bad? The physical atheist the other night, probably during the worst times, I think, and yeah, I reckon. I was watching the ball game the other night, amen. And March Madness, you know that. Oh, amen. Like y'all don't watch ball games. Hypocrites, you do too, amen. If you ain't watching ball games, you're doing something else beside that. But anyway, I was watching the ball game. And I don't turkey hunt, so I watch ball games. Now we see where we're going. I was watching a ball game, and Sister Harrison and I have been witnesses to this atheist guy. And I'm not going to tell you his name because I promised him that I wouldn't say nothing about him, about his name. But y'all would pray for him. God knows his name. And we was on social media, on Facebook and stuff, and he actually said something. He made this comment on his Facebook wall, said that he had gotten right with God. And immediately I saw it. Man, I typed right in, well, praise the Lord, you know. Man, I rejoice with you, man. Come by, man, we'll have sweet fellowship and stuff. And then he says, look, preacher, I was just playing. He says, I'm an atheist. And I made the comment. I said, it's funny to me, more atheists talk more about God than most Christians do. They do. And shut him up. And then he started texting me on my telephone. We carried a long conversation on that. But you know something, ladies and gentlemen? What really bothers me is this, that the philosophical atheist is the one like him, believe that there is not a God, okay? But what really is worse than that is the practical atheist. Those Christians who believe there is a God and live like there is a God on Sunday, but Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, they live like there's no God.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is tonight, if God gives you 365 more days to your life, is your life going to be more pleasing to him? Huh? Is it? Look down at verses of Scripture. Look also in verse number 8, the Bible says here. The Bible says, and he answered and said unto him, he says, Lord, let it alone this year till I shall dig about it. And he dug it. And if it bear fruit, then well, he says. Hey, if God gives you one more year to live, would your life not only be pleasing, but is it going to be productive for the Lord? You hear me?
Yeah.
You would expect at least one fig tree off this tree in 7 years' time, wouldn't you, Brother Donald? At least one. You know something, my dad, God rest his soul, he's done went out to be with the Lord, but he loved birds, all kinds of birds, and he fed birds in his backyard, and he could call up quail like crazy. He'd sit there on a back patio and he'd whistle like a Bob White, and he'd call them up there, you know. But I imagine house cats and everything else, and coyotes and stuff, kind of put a hindrance on quail and stuff. Anyway, we raised chickens and stuff too. Raised a lot of quail and turn them loose so we can hunt them later on and stuff. And I remember when we had a pack of chickens, and every year it came eyeballs and we put bands on their feet. So we know who was actually producing what eggs, amen. And if he ever got a hen that wasn't producing eggs, we ended up calling that chicken out or actually having some chicken stew or chicken and dumplings, amen. 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 That's the same principle that actually God is actually taking with this vineyard, with this right here, and this parable that he's speaking right here. Those Christians that are not producing, God says, I'm going to call them out, amen. He says, I'm going to cut them down. Look at verse number 9. He says, if they bear fruit, then well, but if did not, then after this, they should be cut off, he says. They should be cut down. I mean, honestly, ladies and gentlemen, hey, our God has commanded fruit from us. But most Christians, ladies and gentlemen, are more worried about their look than about their life for the Lord.
Amen.
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 Go run by the gym and see what happens.
Yeah.
Saturday mornings and Sunday mornings and through the week and stuff, I sit in my office and I see people from time to time. They'll run up and down the road. They'll jog up. And there's nothing wrong with bodily exercise. The Bible says it profit little. And there's nothing wrong with that. But I wonder how much time has been spent on their knees before the Lord, praying for a service, praying for your preacher, praying for your teacher, amen. So many Christians get so disgruntled inside of churches, and oftentimes it's their own fault because they don't invest their time in prayer. You show me a disgruntled church member, I'll show you somebody that's quit praying, that has stopped reading their Bible, amen. Amen. Will you be productive for this year for the Lord if God gives you 365 more days? You going to be producing for the Lord? Amen.
Amen.
Notice in verse number 9 right here, quickly tonight, he says this right here. Not only is your life going to be pleasing to the Lord, not only is it going to be productive to the Lord, but is your life going to be prolonged by the Lord? Because the Bible says right here, he says, and if it bear fruit, well. And if not, after that, thou what? After what? Y'all can read it, can't you?
Cut it down.
Cut it down. Get rid of it. You know, I mean, why should God give you clothes on your back, shoes on your feet? I mean, honestly, feed you, clothe you, bless you coming and bless you going, and you still remain in status quo. Never change, never convicted, never a testimony utters from your lips. Never a witness to somebody outside this church. Never a song of praise. Never a hand raised. You sit there like a spiritual knot on a spiritual log.
You're right.
Your status quo. You could be one of those ones that Jesus is talking about here.
Right.
You know, some of you are listening to this message, and you might be 182 days into your year, your spiritual year, and you only have 183 days left, which is half of 365. You might be that far into your spiritual year and you have not made no spiritual change yet. It's status quo. Hey, I applaud you for being here on Wednesday night. And probably this message is needful for that Sunday morning crowd. Would you agree to that? Sure, amen. But I wonder tonight, though, I mean, you've come this far, and by the lack of attendance of somebody else, it's got you disgruntled. You know something? Their attendance should not affect your service for the Lord.
Amen.
You hear me? Don't you hear me? Their attendance should not affect your service for the Lord.
Right.
They didn't save you. They didn't keep you. They can't keep you. They can't save you. Amen. Amen. Hey, therefore, ladies and gentlemen, don't get disgruntled when they don't come. Amen.
Right.
Their absence. Amen.
Amen.
Their mishap. Hey, their fault are not here, not yours.
Right.
You had your will away tonight. This building would be full even already. Which is that not so?
Amen.
If God gives you another year, though, is your life going to be prolonged for the Lord? You see, you might be 182 days into your spiritual year with the Lord, and you're still at status quo. You might be 364 days into your year, and you're still at status quo, and you ain't made no change yet. Man, you and your wife has been to argument. Man, you said, honey, I'm going to do right. I'm going to do better. You done all right for just a couple of days, and now you're right back at the same old self again. She ain't going to tolerate it.
You're right.
You ain't going to tolerate it. Amen. If the shoe's on the other foot, you're not going to tolerate it. Amen. Amen or oh me.
Yeah.
You see, ladies and gentlemen, God has blessed Bethel Baptist Church. You can look around, has he not?
Amen.
Lord have mercy.
Preaching well, brother.
Amen. God has blessed Bethel Baptist Church. He has. Man, you can look around you and tell. But ladies and gentlemen, along with those blessings comes responsibility.
Yes,
sir. Hey, we can get in our comfort zone. And we think, well, we got our own cruise control now. Therefore, we can just coast right on into the New Jerusalem. That ain't what this Bible says right here. We're to be laboring,
right.
Not lazy.
Right.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. Well, that goes over like a lead brick, don't it? Huh? We're to be laboring, not lazy. Amen. Amen.
You're right.
Most of us get pumped and primed up for Sunday morning. And hey, by the way, we need to be in prayer on Sunday morning.
Amen.
We need to be in the meditation and in the mood for worship. Amen.
Right.
Amen. That's right. God gives you one more year. Is your life going to be prolonged this year? Or has God looked down on you tonight? Man, thinking, man, I've saved them. I've blessed them. I've answered their prayer. And they never change. They'll do all right for maybe one day, 2 days a week. And they're right back to their same old self again. They're back. They told me they wouldn't watch pornography no more. Now they've already started going back on the computer. You see, used to have to go up to the bookstore up there in Lexington or Asheboro and go up to the smutty section over there and used to have to pick up magazines. But now the devil has actually made it. Amen.
You're right.
Amen. Just read the paper. Amen. Just read the paper. Y'all read the same stuff I do, don't you? I just read the paper the other day where they said the number one search topic on the internet is pornography. Amen. Amen. You can't never get that stuff out of your mind. It burns inscriptions on your mind. It causes lust. Amen. Lust. Lust bringing forth sin. Sin bringing forth death, the Bible says. Amen. That's right. That's right. Hey, if you keep going on at status quo, are you going to be here in a year's time from now?
That's good, brother.
Is God really going to prolong your life that long? After all the blessings he's bestowed upon you? Mm-hmm. After he's cultivated you?
Yes,
reared you up? You remember that little song the little kids used to sing, sister? He's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. Huh? Y'all remember that song? You ain't going to say amen to me that bobblehead. Huh? Oh, yeah. He's still working on you. Man, he's still working. He's working on all of us, by the way. The Bible says that good work for he performed until the day of redemption.
Yeah.
He'll work on us all the way until we get to New Jerusalem. Praise God for it. But some people are lagging and lacking behind. They made vows. And man, they said, Lord, man, Lord, I really want this prayer to be answered. Lord, if you do this, I'm really going to straighten up. And I'm really going to live for the Lord now. Now, those feelings, things that waned off.
Yeah.
Now you went right back to your same old place, or your same old spot. You see, people, Christians, ladies and gentlemen, they don't backslide and just say, well, one day, well, I ain't going to church anymore. I said, I'm done. They don't do that. You know where they get cold-hearted at? Sitting right where you sit.
Mm-hmm.
Doing exactly what you're doing. You know, the Bible tells us in the book of Numbers, Brother Donald, the Bible tells us in the book of Numbers is this, that be sure your sins will find you out.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it says. No, don't say that, Brother Cole.
Yes.
Numbers 32, verse number 33. Don't the Bible say that? Be sure your sins will find you out. That's not what the Bible says, right? Sure it does. You know something? It's funny though. I mean, I use that as a plea to get sinners to come to an altar, and there's nothing wrong with that. But you know what Moses was actually telling the nation of Israel? They're about their sin. What their sin was? He was telling them, he says, man, they was fixing to go over to the promised land, and he looks back and tells them, he says, I'm going to tell you what right now. He says, be sure your sins will find you out. And what it was this. When they got over there, the Bible says that half of that tribe of Reuben and Gad, they wanted to stay behind the well-watered plains. And stay behind. He says, y'all go ahead and go up to the front. Y'all fight. Just let us know how things is going on. We're going to going to sit back here and build houses and fix sandwiches for you guys, and we'll come check on you every now and then and be sure everything's all right. And man, Joshua looks back at that crowd, and you know what he tells them? He says, I'll tell you what, you better be sure your sin will find you out. What was he talking about? I'll tell you what he was talking about. He was talking about the greatest sin inside the church, and it is this. You ready? Look up here, pull up real close and listen real good. It's the sin of doing nothing.
Amen.
So if you want your spirituality to keep waning off, you ain't got to run to the house of ill repute. You don't have to start cussing like a sailor.
You're right.
You know what you do? Absolutely nothing.
Amen.
You want your marriage to lose its fervency? You want your kids to go astray and have needles in their arms and to be dope addicts and stuff? You know what you got to do? You don't have to. You don't have to introduce them all to that stuff. You know what you got to do? Absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
You know what you do? Hey! In order to kill a spirit inside the church, you know what you got to do to lower the morale of your own household? You guessed it. Absolutely nothing. You know what you got to do to kill this church? You know what you got to do to kill the tenants of this church? You got it again. Absolutely nothing. You know what you got to do to lose your job? The place where you work at. You know what you got to do to lose your job? Come on. Now you get me. If God gives you one more year, what's going to change? What's going to change? Let me show you this and I'm done. Look at it here one more time, please. Verse number 8, he answered and said unto him, says, Lord, let it alone this year also. He's begging, God, give this tree one more year. And he says, I'm going to dig about it. And he dug it. He done what he said. Verse number 9, he says, and if it bear fruit, he says, well. He says, if not, then after this, thou shalt cut it down. You know something? I'm saddened by the Christians that we have to bury. Good Christians. Some of them by disease and stuff, and I understand that. But there's some Christians I've buried along the way. I know for a fact they got God in a killing mood. And God took them out of this place by the way that they was living, by the way that they was doing. By the way they was not doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they're sitting somewhere now. Don't even know if they're saved. Could be like a maniac in Gadara. Not even clothed and even sitting in the right mind anymore. You know what you got to do to get that status? You know what you have to do to get that status? Bethel?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely nothing. You going to be productive this year? God gives you another year? Might not be here. I'm talking to people right now. You're not even going to be here by this time next year. I don't know what the case may be, but you know something? It's high time we wake. Man, you know what I really like about Sanballat and Tobiah? Sanballat and Tobiah is in the book of Nehemiah. I'm closing. Trust me, I'm closing. Sanballat and Tobiah are in the book of Nehemiah. The Bible says that, and I really love what they say about Donald, because the Bible says they had a mind to work. They had a mind to work. And the Bible says as they was fixing the gates, and they was fixing the breaches, the Bible says they worked willingly. And the Bible says they had a trowel in one hand and a sword in the other hand. They didn't let some mossy-backed Christian.
Yeah.
They didn't let some Satanism crowd. They didn't let the worldly crowd stop them from working for the Lord. God didn't save them. My preacher didn't save me, and I'm not serving God because of my preacher.
Right.
My deacon didn't save me, and I'm not serving God because of him. My wife didn't save me, though she's come close a couple of times. But I'm not serving God because of my wife. I'm serving God because of what he has done for me.
Yeah.
And I figure this much. As long as this country boy's got breath in his lungs, I figure it's about high time I start living for the Lord.
Amen.
I figure as much Cain as I raised when I was lost, I figured I can show that much appreciation for the Lord for him, for what he's done for me.
Hey, you're right.
We all deserved hell, didn't we?
Yeah.
seven of you agree with me anyway. We all deserve hell.
Yes, we do.
And it's high time we start living and being productive Christians along the way. How many gospel tracts you give out? You know something, what you have here can be even much more than what you got already.
Yeah,
sure.
Amen.
You know, I mean, is your life going to be pleasing the Lord? I mean, hey, some people run from the call of God. Man, God knocks on their heart's door, wants them to preach, and they run. But some people even got a song in your heart. Maybe Sister Sue can even play it. And you wanted to. And you're just not the stand-up type of guy, are you? Not yet, you're not. That's not being productive for the Lord. You know why? Because some people need to hear that song.
Right.
Some people need to hear your testimony. We have them in our church, Brother Cole. We have a testimony sometimes, like a popcorn, much like what y'all have here. And I praise the Lord for it. And man, they'll stand up, and we get the normal people to stand up. And I'm not making fun of them, and that's great. And I applaud what they're doing and what they've said and how God has worked in their life. But man, I've got some people in my church that has never stood up, has never raised their hand, has never sung a song. And they're just sitting there like a knot on the log. Are they saved? I suppose so. But they ain't doing nothing. And you know something? That's not only in my church, but I expect to say, that's right here too. You know what you have to do to kill your spirituality? Absolutely nothing. You know what you got to do to kill your marriage? Nothing. You know what you got to do to kill your church? Nothing. Just keep doing nothing. The Bible says he dug about that tree. He says he gave him 365 more days to live. The Bible says if it wasn't producing fruit, wasn't praising the Lord, if it wasn't being productive, God says, I'm going to cut it down. I'm going to cut it down. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, I thank you tonight, dear Lord Father, for this attentive crowd tonight. Lord, they've been very patient with me. And these few and scattered words, Lord Father, we've had here this evening. I pray, Father, during this invitation time, Lord, that you would please speak to hearts, dear God. Lord Father, we're all at the capacity, Lord Father, in some way or another, we could actually do more for you. Lord, there's some not even lifting a finger yet, dear Lord Father. Lord, they're not even tithing yet. God, they're not even giving their time or their talent, Lord. And God, they're just status quo. And God, they haven't, Lord, if a Jehovah Witness shows up, Lord, on the doorstep, they couldn't fend themselves off. God, they haven't grown or matured, Lord. No family devotions, no private time. Oh, God, help them, Lord. Not the remainder. Lord, there's no fruit. God, they never invite. Lord, they just come here and enjoy the showers of blessings, Lord, the good, great services, God, here at Bethel. Lord, I appreciate them being here, but Father, help them to be a part of it, Lord, and not to do just nothing. Help us once, Lord, tonight, Father, some of us has reneged on our vows to you. God, we want to be more vibrant, more on fire Christian, and God, it has waned somewhere along the road. Help us to rekindle that fire, Father, in Jesus' name. I pray our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Sister Sue begins to play on the piano. Would you stand with me tonight?